Good morning. Welcome to St. John's and our 11 o'clock service. Welcome. It's a wonderful day today. We are blessed with the members of the class of 2015. They will be providing leadership in our worship service. We also have our new Youth Wins group that will be providing our prelude. And Palmer Rowan will be doing a solo on his trombone. And also we have our Foundation Youth Choir singing today with us. So it is a wonderful day here at St. John's. Our call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Thank you.
We present now the class of 2015.
Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, you create life from the earth and breathe into it new life and meaning. You empower us with knowledge and skills to aid one another as we live out our lives. Bless our gathering this day as we recall your grace and kindness and celebrate endings and new beginnings. May we strengthen one another as we walk together with you through this life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Welcome again this morning to St. John's. We are certainly glad to have this class of 2015 with us today. Not tomorrow, but Monday a week, we invite you to come to Sunny Monday. They will be meeting over in the new Faith Center. And the program will be sort of a behind the scenes of how the Faith Center came about. So if you are not regularly attending Sunny Monday but want to know more about the Faith Center, please join us. Make your reservations by calling the church office. Also, Vacation Bible School will be here very soon. It's the week of June 15th. So please sign up your children, grandchildren, and I'm sure Stephanie Lord would still be interested in some volunteers if someone's interested. Take time now to fill out the friendship pads. They should have been located near the center aisle. Pass those down to those around you. Today we are receiving new members. We have two couples who are joining today. If you will turn to page 38 in your hymnals as Diana and Carlton Brown come forward. Diana and Carlton, there they are. Carlton has a long history with Methodist. His middle name is Asbury. And they recently moved to Aiken from Somerville, where they were members at Bethany United Methodist Church. And Carlton had a career in telecommunications, and Diana worked in administration with a charter school. Also, we welcome Joanne and Anthony Kafara, if you'll come forward too. They have lived in Aiken a few years and are retired. They lived in New Jersey, and Joanne worked with Colgate-Palmolive, and Tony retired from Johnson & Johnson, and they were transferring their membership from a sister church here in Aiken.
It's a pleasure. No, nephew. Nephew. And Francis Asbury was the first bishop in the United Methodist Church. And so that's a great heritage. And so we welcome Carlton and Diana, and we welcome Tom and Joanne. And I'm so sorry, Cafaro and
Diana.
Brown, Diana. Diana, Joanne. Okay. All it takes is a microphone to get me thrown off. We're working on it. We're working on it. Being in a new facility, this is an adventure. I hope you all enjoy it. And we all, I think, hope that the air conditioner works better, right? Anybody in favor of that? Okay, yes. All right. Now, page 38. As members together with you, as members of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? And if so, please say, I will.
I will.
As members together of this congregation of St. John's United Methodist Church, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? And now, brothers and sisters of the congregation, the commendation and welcome. Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Thank you so much, and I want to welcome you. Thank you so much, Joanne. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Diana, and thank you, Carlton. God bless you, and Nancy has bags for you. And if any of you are interested in joining the church, we'd be more than welcome to invite you either forward here in one of our services or at another time in another place of your choosing. Just let us know.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated as we pray. Dear God, thank you for blessing us with the numerous memories, friendships, and lessons learned at St. John's. What we have experienced here has shaped us into who we are today and who we will become. We pray for your guidance as we step into this new and unsure time in our lives. Keep us close to you always and let your word be our guide in troubled times. We ask all this through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who has taught his disciples, and who has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Forever and ever. Amen.
At this time, we invite our ushers to come forward to receive God's tithes and his offering, and we will not have the middle hymn of preparation, so our crucifer will lead our children out during this time as well.
Be seated, please. Again, we will forego the second hymn, and instead we will enjoy a multimedia presentation of the graduates.
It's only for a moment you are mine to hold. The plans that heaven has for you will all too soon unfold. So many different prayers I'll play for all that you might do. But most of all, I want to see that you're walking in the truth. If I never told you, I want you to know. And as I watch you grow, I pray that God would fill your heart with dreams, and that faith gives you the courage to dare to do great things. I'm here for you, whatever this life brings. So let my love give you roots and help you find your wings. May passion be the wind that leads you through the days, and may conviction keep you strong and guide you on your way. May there be many moments that make your life so sweet. Oh, but more than memories, I pray that God would fill your heart with dreams, and that faith gives you the courage to dare to do great things. I'm here for you, whatever this life brings. So let my love give you roots and help you find your wings. 'Cause it's not living if you don't reach for the sky. I'll have tears as you take off, but I'll cheer you as you fly. And I pray that God would fill your heart with dreams, and that faith gives you the courage to dare to do great things. I'm here for you, whatever this life brings. So let my love give you roots and help you find your wings. And help you find your wings. Help you find your wings. would fill your hearts with dreams, and that faith gives you the courage to dare to do great things. I'm here for you, whatever this life brings. So let my love give you roots and help you find your wings.
Today's scripture comes from John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Brianna Downs, and I'm a part of the Aiken High School class of 2015. We seniors have had a long, tiring year, but I'm sure we are all glad our hard work has paid off in the end, because I know I am. We all have been a part of this church, gone to the services, and met the extraordinary individuals who make up its congregation. We all will, without a doubt, always remember St. John's as a part of our childhood and our family as we head off on our different and unique paths. Throughout my 4 years at Aiken High School, I always look forward to and even celebrated the fact that the time that I spent at Aiken High was moving so fast. Now that I'm so close to leaving, it is finally settled that I'm leaving all of my family and friends behind and moving toward my future and pursuing something for myself, which is scary. Each of us seniors are essentially the branches that are shaped and grown around this church and God's teachings. At some point, though, change is inevitably going to take place. But it should not negatively impact our relationship with Jesus Christ, who is the true vine. In fact, it's my prayer that the changes we face help draw us closer to Christ as we go throughout college and the rest of our lives. In John chapter 15, we are reminded that we will always be a part of this central vine, or the Father. We have all been taught to minister to others and to always be fruitful messengers of the word. But isn't it so complicated when our everyday lives are filled with such complications and changes? God will always remain our true vine, but it is far more complicated to remain in him throughout all of this, especially when faced with tough situations and such busy schedules in our daily lives. Each and every time we falter in our walk with the Lord, we have to remind ourselves that overwhelming situations are never as drastic as they could be. There will always be a worse degree of suffering, and Paul is the very best example of this and one of my favorite. Philippians was written entirely because Paul was a prisoner awaiting trial in Rome. Paul writes this letter, or the entire book of Philippians, to the church of Philippi, reminding them to always be thankful and always be faithful in any situation. One of my favorite Bible verses, and one that I've always gone back to throughout all my years of high school, when I needed a reminder, I guess, is Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7, which states, "Always be full of joy in the Lord. I say it again, rejoice. Let everyone see that you are considerate in all that you do. Remember, the Lord is coming soon. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Paul's constant faith and positivity is exactly the belief that needs to be held by each and every one of us and anyone whose life is consistently changing. Though he's in Rome, away from anything assumed to be his typical surroundings, Paul is only further inspired to minister to anyone and everyone he possibly can. If Paul can find a way to find hope and minister to others, it is entirely possible that we seniors can find a way to never lose track of the strong, never-ending branches that we have always been on. St. John's has made such a large impact on each and every one of our lives, thanks to the loving parents, helpful mentors, and inspiring opportunities and events that we have taken place on while being a part of this community. It is through these things that has made us all the more ready to begin a new chapter in our lives, all while remembering the faith that got us to this point.
Good morning. My name is Sophie Nance. Next week, I'm graduating from Aiken High School. One of the sports I played at Aiken High School was cross country. And often at cross-country meets, I would see t-shirts that the meet had made to sell. And very often, these t-shirts had Bible verses written on them. One of the ones I saw the most was the familiar verse from Philippians, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." But sometimes when I saw that quote on the shirt, I would doubt the sincerity of it. I think the emphasis is sometimes placed on the wrong part of the verse. I think it should be placed on, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." It doesn't say I can do all things because Christ strengthens me, but through Christ who strengthens me. Well, what does doing things through Christ mean? He is the vine and we are the branches. We receive spiritual sustenance and life through him because he died for our sins. Well, since God provides us with spiritual sustenance and strength and love, aren't we expected in a way to pass this on to other people? That way, we can bear fruit just like branches on a vine. Sometimes the bearing of this fruit can be halted by the branch being severed from the vine. One of the many things that can do this is our negative response to change. Whether it be a high school graduate going off to college, or a college graduate starting their first job, or a couple having a baby for the first time, or a parent sending a child away from home, or a person having to give up their job for retirement, or a person losing a loved one. Times of change can be very hard to accept. But even through these difficult times of change, we must remain in Christ. Times of change are not always a bad thing. They can be an opportunity. We can grow in faith and bear more fruit, or we can recede in faith and let our fruit wither and die. It is our choice. I am reminded that in Jewish translations, the word tabernacle, which means a house of worship, can be translated in two different ways. The first way is a place that meets. This can be interpreted as a place where people meet to worship or a place where people meet with God. The second way it can be translated is a place that moves. A tabernacle is a place that moves. See, the church is not necessarily a building. It is us, the people of the church. It will move with us, but only if we choose to bring it along as we remain in faith. We must bring it with us and stay close to the vine even as we move through life. Many of the people in this church have stayed true to the vine and have embodied the church. One of these people is my former basketball coach, Meredith Legg, who was a loved member of St. John's. She was just a few years older than us graduates when she was found to have a rare form of cancer. Although most people would say that Meredith did not get dealt a fair hand, she stayed true to her faith throughout her battle with cancer. In fact, she grew in her faith exponentially. She also encouraged many young athletes and friends like myself in our faith journeys. Her branch bore much fruit. Many people like Meredith in our church have undergone trials during periods of change. Some have endured cancer like her. Some have lost loved ones. And some have had changes that made them doubt their faith. But I have seen many of my mentors in this church stay true to the vine and not lose their faith, even when trials and tribulations have come their way. specifically for our graduates today, let us follow the example of Meredith and many others in our St. John's family, and let the church move with us as we cling to the vine and hold on to faith.
Thank you, Sophie and Bree. Thank you for all of you graduates and the young adults and graduates who've gone before you and have been a witness. I had not scripted this, but I may regret it, but I want to say thank you to Kevin Kisner, who gives a good role model for all of us, and Brittany, and of course their sweet daughter Kate, and Kevin's mom and dad, Christy and Steve. But right over here. I'd like to read from Proverbs chapter 4, verses 6 through 9. Do not forsake wisdom, and she will protect you. Love her, and she will watch over you. Wisdom is supreme, therefore get wisdom. Though it cost all you have, get understanding. Esteem wisdom, and she will exalt you. Embrace her, and she will honor you. She will set a garland of grace on your head and present you with a crown of splendor. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. On this commencement 2015, these are words for not only the graduates, but they're words for me, and perhaps words for you as well. Let me begin with a story. Perhaps you've heard the story of the pilot and his three passengers, a fifth grade Boy Scout, a priest, and a famous astrophysicist. The pilot in this story frantically opens up the cockpit, steps out, addresses the other three, and says, "The plane is going down, and we only have three parachutes. I have a family, and they need me." And so he grabs a parachute and jumps to safety. And then the famous astrophysicist says, "I am the smartest man in the world. The world needs me." And so he grabs and jumps. And then the priest looks at the young fifth grader, the Boy Scout, and says, "Son, I've lived a good life. I don't have a family. I'm ready to meet my maker. You take the parachute." And the Boy Scout says, "Hold on, Father. Hold on, Father. You see, we're both all right. The smartest man in the world just jumped out of the airplane with my knapsack." Are we smarter than a fifth grader? Are you smarter than a fifth grader? Do we have wisdom? The difference between wisdom and knowledge is evident in this story. Knowledge is having the right information, and wisdom is putting it to good use. The scientist had knowledge but did not know how to use it. And I know a lot of smart people today, successful people, affluent people, but they're jumping out of airplanes wearing knapsacks filled with knowledge and stuff they don't need instead of the parachute of God-given wisdom. What is needed in my book, in this information age in which we live, is more wisdom, not more knowledge. My task on this commencement day is to help you, all of us, to commence, a.k.a. to begin to live with wisdom. James chapter 1, verses 5 through 6 says that God eagerly wishes to give all of us wisdom who dare to ask. Proverbs chapter 4 that I just read from, verses 6 through 9, tells us that it's wisdom, if we value it, that will protect us. If we value it, it will watch over us, exalt us, honor us, and even give us grace. And the best source of wisdom and the best source of everything that I know of in life is Jesus Christ. And he said about himself in John chapter 14, verse 6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." So I could end there, but counting on his wisdom, I want to offer these tidbits on this graduation day, 2015. I share these 18 thoughts in no particular order. You can take them or leave them or even enjoy a nap. Number one, up until now, graduates, especially during your senior year, you have been building a resume to get into the college of your choice and or to win a scholarship. And some of you have been building a resume for a different track after after high school. But either way, from here on, my advice to you is instead of building a resume, build relationships. Build relationships. Do your work, for sure, but if from here on out in life you focus on relationships, you will get into the grad school of your choice or a leg up on the career in the next step of your life. Build relationships over a resume. Number two, don't post anything on Snapchat, Facebook, or Instagram that you don't want a future girlfriend, boyfriend, spouse, employer, mother-in-law, father-in-law, or anyone to see, because social media is permanent, so be careful. Even if you set your Snapchat limit at 1 second, it may last in someone's brain file forever. Number three, avoid selfies. Our self-centered, self-obsessed, narcissistic society is too full of itself. Don't be one of those people who takes pictures of their meal, their clothes, and God knows what else. The world has little use for name-dropping, pompous, full of yourselves, entitled people who have a preoccupation with appearance over substance. Remember that pride goeth before a fall, says the book of Proverbs, and the branch that hangs the lowest is the one that always bears the most fruit. If a fraternity, a sorority, or a group of friends want you to be something or do something that you are not, they are not the friends that you need anyway. Number four, avoid at all costs having a plagiarized life. Copying someone else's work and claiming it as your own is stealing. Give credit where credit is due. Don't depend on Google, Wikipedia, or WikiHow for your answers to the problems of life, because if you cheat and plagiarize, you will be exposed as a poser in every area of life. Do your own work and be proud of it. Number five, keep reading. And continue to do independent research for the rest of your life. Make sure that your ideas and your writing is original. Expand your vocabulary. Read for pleasure and fun. My suggestions would include J.R.R. Tolkien, with the Moody Blues playing on your earbuds in the background, or anything by N.T. Wright or the Bible. Not necessarily in that order, but read and enjoy. Number six, your biggest liability is your need to succeed and to please people. Your biggest liability is your need to succeed and to please people. It's okay if you fail, if you learn from your mistakes and move on. If you make pleasing people your goal in life, then you will be a slave to everyone else, and you will play second fiddle to whomever you're sucking up to. Number seven, when caught in a dilemma, don't try to force things, panic, or struggle. Instead, practice purposeful pausing. Walk away. Take a break. Take at least a mental break. Do something unrelated to your problem, and then come back to it. This gives you space and opportunity for an epiphany, a new insight. Call it white space or whatever. Just do it, and a new way forward will present itself. Trust me. Number eight, every successful person knows that life has foul lines, just like a baseball field. Some things are in play, and some things aren't. Some things are out of bounds and plain wrong. They are off limits. I don't care what the misbehavior is, even if it makes you supposedly happy, it won't for long. So have standards and live up to them. It's called integrity. It comes from the old French, integere, which means in touch, that you have a core of beliefs upon which everything else in your life connects or is in touch. Therefore, everyone needs to have a core set of values about which you will not hedge, compromise, or desert. Number nine. Do your classwork and your necessary labor every day in spite of the adage, all work and no play makes Jack a very dull boy. If you work, on your assignments or projects along and along, you'll actually have more time to relax and play responsibly. Cramming doesn't promote effective learning, nor does procrastinating and waiting until the last minute foster quality work. My adage is, get it done and you'll have more fun. Number 10, yes, you will have a laptop, iPhone, smartphone, and or tablet to use in life, but don't forget to look up more than you look down. If you're not careful, you'll run into a telephone pole. Plus, you might miss meeting the most important person of the rest of your life. Look up! Instead of looking down, your neck's going to freeze in that position. Look up and listen to people before you forget what their voices sound like. And there will come a time when you forget what their voices sound like. And don't text and drive by looking down, because your voice will be the first one that's forgotten, because you will die. Use proper decorum. Use proper decorum and mute your cell phones around people you love and in situations that demand and command respect. Mute your cell phones around people you love. Number 11, think with your head and not with your hormones. Experimentation only belongs in the lab, but don't do anything improper there either. Love and sex are very often two different things. So avoid the complication until you're ready. There's nothing casual about casual sex, and it will have permanent consequences. Watch out for users and abusers who want benefits without commitment. Number 12, an observation. An observation. The music that you love right now in high school will be your favorite music for the rest of your life. Maybe it's the emotional connection to these wonderful years. But whatever the reason, just accept it and enjoy it. Let the music bring back all the good times and even all the tumultuous ones. There's something therapeutic about it. By the way, it doesn't hurt to make new playlists for every age and stage in life. And guess what? Your future children will have their own playlist, and they probably won't sound like yours. But that's okay. That's life. C'est la vie, n'est-ce pas? 13. Internships are something that will help you decide your direction in life. If offered an apprenticeship or an internship or a mentor, go for it. You get paid for an opportunity to test drive a career, but be careful in calling it a career. A calling, which comes from the Latin vocare, vocatio, where we get our word voice, is always better than a career. Callings will always make you happier than a career, so be careful and listen to the big V, voice. What is your calling? It's better than a career. Sure. Number 14, sure. You hardly ever use cash or a checkbook, and that's great. Plastic is the way to go. But being pre-approved at a college orientation day by the bank of all the tables of those offering credit cards to freshmen, being pre-approved for a credit card does not mean that you have to apply for it. And when you use your debit card, like most of us, for everything, be money wise and make sure you check your balances often, if not every day. Avoid student and personal debt like the plague. And with all your transactions, keep your identity safe. Because after all, that may be a pun, but your purchases reveal what your identity is. What do your purchase habits say about yours? Number 15, avoid platonic thought. The philosopher Plato taught that mind and matter are two separate things, and that our minds are good and matter is evil. So what he promoted, and it is now our soup du jour of philosophical thinking, is that if you don't mind, it won't matter. Other interpretations of this mind over matter line of thinking say things like, if it feels good, do it. Or YOLO, you only live once. What a crock! Whether it's drugs, alcohol, or sex, there will be a payday someday. Therefore, don't be foolish. Or I would use this word, don't be. You're not invincible. Accidents happen. Buy life insurance. And do not ever separate your thinking from your doing. Number 16. Then there's what is called virtual reality, which is Platonic thought on steroids, with its reliance on the separation of mind over matter. This is the philosophical underpinning of our current worldview, with its reliance on computers, virtual online relationships, video gaming, fantasy leagues that don't really exist. We must not forget that as much as we would like some of these things to be real, they're not. We're all neurotic, and neuroses are something that we all use to help us escape realities we don't like. But we should not let Game of Thrones, Trivia Crack, or Candy Crush Saga, or whatever the latest virtual game is, take over our lives to the point where our neuroses become an actual psychotic break from reality. So when I say get real, I mean it. Beware the temptation of living in a fake world with fake friends. Number 17, simple advice. Never buy a new car. Let someone else eat the depreciation. A new car loses at least 11% of its value the second you drive it off the lot. That's $2,200 on a $20,000 car. Therefore, using that as a frame of reference and idea, therefore, never make quick, I just gotta have it, knee-jerk decisions, whether it's about shopping, deciding on a major, or job selection, or friend selection. You need to be adaptable. Never settle for anyone or anything. Change is the only constant in life, so as much as you like the new this or the new that, remember, it's going to change. Get used to the fact and do your best to slow down your decision-making through meditation, contemplation, prayer, reflection. Number 18. Remember, everything does happen for a reason. And you are the usual reason. Everybody loves that saying, everything happens for a reason. And they're right. But most people use that saying to make God the reason. But God loves us and the whole creation enough to give us free will. So don't blame God for the crud in your life. If God caused the pain and calamities like flooding in Texas or cancer here, then God would be worse than a child abuser, and God is not. God loves us enough that He gave us Jesus. So both bad and good things happen mostly because of your choices, my choices, our choices, or the choices of others. Bad things also get added nudges from the general decay that's in the world that causes storms and cancer and so forth, or from evil. But remember, really remember, you are the primary mover of the course of your life. God's providence will always be with you through Jesus Christ. He will lead you. He will guide you. But it's up to you to make the final decisions and do something about it. So I guess what I'm trying to say is this. Take responsibility. It's yours. So in conclusion, as I have thought about this graduation and commencement, I have, in my own way of saying and verifying that the music you like in high school is the music you like forever, I have recalled a favorite song from my senior year in high school. It's the song Tin Man by America. The line that keeps going through my head is, and I'm not going to sing it, but Oz never But Oz never did give nothing to the Tin Man that he didn't already have. You remember that? Some of you remember that? But Oz never did give nothing to the Tin Man that he didn't already have. I mean, we could start singing that. But here's the deal. The Wizard of Oz didn't give anything to the Tin Man that he didn't already have. Because the Tin Man wanted what? He wanted a heart. But he had already proven that he already had a heart, or he wouldn't have been frozen solid from all the rust from all of his tears, wanting something that he already had. The lion wanted courage, but if you think about the trip that Dorothy and that motley crew took, you know that the lion already had courage. So Oz never did give nothing to the lion that he didn't already have. And what about the scarecrow who wanted a brain? Well, he proved along the trip that he already had a brain. So Oz never did give nothing to the scarecrow that he didn't already have. And you have already been given by God Almighty everything you need. Love from parents, love from others, love from the Lord to be able to make your way to your Emerald City, or to the Emerald City, whose path is paved with yellow brick stones. I believe in the book of Revelation they're called streets of gold, but it's still an Emerald City. So you've already got everything you need. Start walking. Start walking. And that goes for all of us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to have an opportunity, as Jimmy Whitesoul and Amy Jernigan come forward, that we're going to send you off with, well, it may not be Tolkien and it may not be N.T. Wright, but it's the Bible. And as you search its pages, it will indeed give you wisdom. So as your names are called, we're going to ask you to stand now. All of our graduates, please stand.
Adam Lewis Beckham, Megan Lynn Cathy, Justin Taylor Connolly, Kaylee Lynn Crenshaw, Christopher James DeMink, Brianna Laura Downs, Carly Jacqueline Downs, Caroline Lee Greer, James David Locke, Taylor Hayes Mabry, Sophia Catherine Nance, Abigail Elizabeth Ray, Claire Huntley Turner, Ryan Christopher Yulee, William Timmerman Wirtz III,
Now I'd like to invite you to stand as we sing our last hymn, number 529, as our graduates and clergy recess. Number 529, How Firm a Foundation.